everybody.
Morning.
Are y'all ready to worship? Come on, stand up. Let's get started. God, we thank you so much for what you have in store for us today. Lord, with all the change and the transition and everything that's going on, Lord, we can feel the excitement. It's building. We see the promised land just over the horizon, and we can't wait to just worship together in whatever building or outside or a tent, wherever, God. We just love being in your presence. God, I pray that you would bless us. Let us have a great time today, Lord. Speak to us. Teach us, God. We love you. We thank you in your name. Amen.
We'll be right back.
like someone that has worked in a restaurant before that knows one of those fun birthday songs? They could come up and lead us in a birthday song. Anybody? Yep. Okay, so we'll sing the old-fashioned one. Here we go. So we don't normally do this unless it's someone that we really just want to embarrass. So like last week, we did a hoedown birthday welcome for Melinda, and then I had a special, anybody like that birthday hoedown? John's a party pooper. That's just all there is to it. So, hey, but one a person asked specifically to embarrass her husband, so we're going to sing Happy Birthday to Kelly. So, Kelly, here it goes. Ready?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Kelly. Happy birthday to you.
Now, we should have Kelly stand on the chair and sing a song, but we won't do that today because we don't want to scare off our guests. All right? So, there you go. Hey, welcome. My name is Spencer Dunlap. I didn't get a chance to see everybody as you came in this morning. We've got a couple of things I just want to bring you up to speed on, and then we're going to jump back into some worship music. But first, I'm just so thankful that you're here. You know, it's just an amazing thing to be able to come here. But today is your last time to worship in this building. And so we're going to enjoy today, and we're going to be able to enjoy what God's up to. And we'll talk more about our transition to the next place for next week. A little bit later, but I'm so thankful you're here. We're praying you'd be here today, and I'm just excited to see what God is up to. And so we've got a couple things that are a little bit different today. One is the kids' classes. Last week, we had just record-breaking attendance, and we had like 40 kids in each of the rooms, and we decided that was not productive or safe or temperature efficient, because like 40 little bodies create so much heat. It was like 98 degrees in those rooms. That's an exaggeration, but it was close, I think. And so what we said is we're just going to hang on to kids' classes until we get to the new place. So a couple weeks of transition. So what that means is we'll still do classes for kindergarten down, and there's still a nursery up here if you need it. But for those other kids that would normally have class today, we're sorry, but it's the best we can do right now with this transition. What it says is it's definitely time to move to a bigger place. Would you agree with that? And so if you, oh, that's good. You can clap for that. And so... So if you need some coloring pages or something to keep the, you know, the first through fourth grade or your 23-year-old, if you need something to stay occupied, well, I'm pretty sure there's some coloring books and some crayons and stuff in the back, and we'll get you hooked up. So just meander back that way, okay? John, you need something? Keep yourself? Okay, there you go. All right, so, hey, I'm thankful you're here. I want to pray, and then we'll jump back in, and we'll get started with some more worship. But my hope, as every day we come together, is that God will change us today. And that we're not here to check a box. We're here to come into God's presence. And I want to pray that He will come and move in this place today as we come together to worship, which is just saying that God is worthy. And so we're going to do that now. So I just want to pray for that. And I hope that you'll pray that with me. Father God, we praise you for who you are. I praise you for what you've done in this place with these people over the last, not even 2 years, that we've been together and worshiping and singing songs of praise to you and praying and communing and giving and learning and growing and maturing. And Father, I pray that today is no different. That today we will grow in you, we will see you, that you will move us. I pray, Father, that you will let us leave here today changed. We'll be transformed in some way, in some area of our life. You'll change the broken areas, that you'll heal brokenness. That today, as we sing these songs of praise, that you will invade this place, that your spirit will flow in this place. We're here because of you, Father. We're here because you are good and glorious and awesome. We praise you for Jesus. We praise you for the Holy Spirit to be with us, moving in us now. God, I pray that we will sense your presence here, that you'll cast away every dark thing, everything that causes us to stumble and gets in our way. That we'll not think about yesterday, not think about those fights this morning or the stress to get here. That we'll not worry about what we have to do tomorrow, but we will just be fully present here in this place, in your presence, with one another, to give glory and honor to you because you're worthy. So, Father, I praise you for all that you are and all that you're doing and all that you will do. In Jesus' name.
Nothing good. to sing our praises, to worship you because of the love that you give us, the love that you showed giving your life for us. Jesus, we worship you. I'm so glad that we can come and worship you for who you are. God, I'm thankful that no matter how far we feel away, no matter how messed up we think we are, God, just like this song sings, there's one thing that was always your main, and it's that your love will never fail. It'll never quit. It'll never run out. God, you never give up on us. Lord, we're just thankful.
Thank you.
constraints of space. I wish we had another option, but for a couple of weeks we'll be working on this transition. We'll talk about it a little bit more here in just a few minutes. But I love to pray. I don't know if you've noticed that. I've been in lots of different churches, and you know, you might have one prayer or two here and there, the beginning and the end, sort of like prayers, the book ends and all the stuff's in the middle. And I'm just not sure that fits me well. I like to just sort of stop and pray at any moment, at any time, because it's amazing to me that God asks us to do it, to talk to Him, to come into a relational connection, to begin a conversation that He began a long time ago with us, to be able to come and to pray, and then to just imagine for a moment that when we pray and when we talk to God, we're talking to the very same God who spoke to Moses or who talked to David, the same God that said, "Let there be light," and it was, the same God that talked to Paul or Saul, the same God that was Jesus in the flesh that walked on this earth and died on a cross. It's the same God that we're talking to when we pray. Does that not amaze you when you really stop and consider? And that He wants us to pray, to talk back, to communicate. I love to pray. And then, of course, we see all sorts of things throughout Scripture that invite us in, tell us things like in Philippians chapter 4 that really says that in everything we should pray. And I hear sometimes from people, actually I hear it a lot from people that say, and it's sort of one of those passing comments, and I'm sure some of you have said it, and I'll tell you the truth, I've said it before in my life, and the idea has been, well, I don't want to sort of bother God with this little thing, this sort of insignificant issue, because there's so much bigger stuff out there, and that's just not right. God invites us to pray in everything, and in fact tells us to pray without ceasing in 1 Thessalonians, to sort of wake up in the morning and enter into this conversation with God that I conclude at the end of the day when I put my head on my pillow, to just constantly be in this state of prayer. I love to be able to do that, and I'm so thankful that we have a God that wants us to talk to Him, not a God who's got His arms folded and back turned and says, "Good luck with all of that." It's not our God. I also love to hear other people pray. I love to listen to the prayers of people, and sometimes that's one of those things people also don't want to do. They don't want to pray out loud. They're afraid they're not going to say the right things or have eloquent language and whatnot. And guess what? God does not care how eloquent your language is. He does not care if you could slip in a big word like sanctification or justification. He doesn't care about any of those things. You know what He cares about is your heart. And I love to listen to people pray. And I love to, I think, because it tells me so much about someone's heart. When I listen to their prayer and I listen to what they're petitioning God for or thanking God for, it tells us something about them. It tells us something about what's going on in their lives. And it helps us to know how to intercede for them when I listen to them pray. It's important. But for instance, here would be an example, I guess. You know, if someone that you hear prays over and over again that God will show them a way to be able to feed hungry people, you could probably guess that they have a heart for hungry people. Would you agree with that? Or if they're praying and asking God for provision in their lives, you might find that there's a need that's not being met, that we can be the answer to God's prayer in. Have you ever thought about that? That as we listen to people pray and God prompts us to move and to sometimes answer those prayers immediately, that's important. Or you hear someone pray and just say, "God, I'm broken. I need help." Again, it invites us in and allows us to hear what God hears and go into action. We hear so much about people's hearts when they pray, and I love that. But we also see something about God Himself and the things that He has told us. We look through the pages of Scripture, and what you find is God. You see Him all through that. Why? Because He gave us the Scripture so that we would know who He is, that we would understand how to communicate. By me being able to say that God wants us to pray in everything, I didn't make that up. I just went and looked at it because He tells us, "I want you to pray without ceasing. I want you to pray in everything. No matter how minuscule it is, I want you to lift it up." Why? Part of it is because it shows that our dependence on Him and our humility to go, "God, I need help even with this little thing." And I'll tell you, sometimes my first prayer is, "God, help me get out of bed and be able to say what I need to say and do what I need to do." to be fully dependent to that degree. It's important. But we also see something about God himself from Jesus. And of course, there's lots of things that we see there. But one of those things that we see about God from Jesus is we see God's heart in the prayers that Jesus prays. You know, I talked about how I love to pray. I hope you do too. But also how we learn about others from their prayers and we hear their heart in those prayers. We see Jesus' heart as we listen to what Jesus prays as well. And so we see Jesus pray throughout Scripture, and that's important. But there's one particular place that he says things that we must know, that we have to know as we proceed in our life together as a community, as we proceed on to the next facility, and as we live out our lives as seekers and believers, yearning to listen to what he has to say. Jesus' prayer tells us something about God's heart that we must know, that we must be attracted to and understand. And so I want to take you to the book of John. And so you can find where I'm going to go around John chapter 14 through 17. I think it's page 1080 if you have a chair Bible. A chair Bible looks like this. There aren't very many of these anymore because we've invited you to take them home if you need a Bible. That's still an open promise. I just need to order more, okay? And so if you need one of these, and someone can have this one if you need it, it's on page 1080 is where we're going to kind of begin and launch from there. But in John, and if you have your own Bible, which is good, I don't know what page it's on. I'm sorry. So don't look at me. Look at the index. You'll find it, okay? Matthew, Mark, Luke, there you go. John's right after that, okay? And so John chapter 14 through 17. Here's what you see in this passage of Scripture. What you see is sort of Jesus' last will and testament. Jesus is moving closer and closer to the cross. And he brings his disciples together, and he has some important things to tell them. I always, in my mind, I think about sort of that deathbed thing where someone, you know, someone that you love is they know they're in those final stages, and they have a few words of wisdom to pass along to the next generation to say, this is sort of my dying wish or my dying message I want you to hear. Have any of you experienced that before? And Jesus now is moving toward the cross, and he has what we would call in theological circles the farewell discourse. It's chapters 14 through 17 where he's saying goodbye and he's starting to wrap a bow on this ministry, and he needs to pass the baton along to the next group who are to take his message forward. And so he says all these amazing things, and I could spend hours and hours and hours just peeling through 14 through 17. I'm just going to let my eyes catch a few places. I just want to bring them to your attention, like on John chapter 14, verse 1. Don't let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. Verse 3, if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Those are important passages that we get out of the Scripture. Or verse 6, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. As politically incorrect as that statement is, it's still true. Yeah. Just like gravity exists, even though you haven't thought about it once today, right? It's still pulling on you because no one's floating away. So gravity works. You don't have to believe in gravity. You can deny gravity all you want. We just have to go up to the roof and we'll prove that it's true. Jesus is the way, whether we like it or not, whether society thinks it's accurate or truthful or whatever. And we go on. How about verse 26 of John 14? But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring you to the remembrance all that I said to you. That's important. We want to remember the things that God has led us to and the things that he's taught. Or chapter 15, how about verse 9? Just as the Father has loved me, I also love you. Abide in my love. What a powerful passage. All by itself, we just take that one. Or verse 13, greater love has no one than this, that one lay down his life for his friends. How important. Jesus is foreshadowing what he's about to do, but also teaching that this is what love looks like, is that you love as he has loved and willing to die even for someone. That's true love. We continue on. Let's look at chapter 16, about verse 8. When he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. That's important. The Holy Spirit convicts us of sin when we go our own way. And on it goes. How about verse 33? These things I've spoken to you so that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. In the world you'll have troubles. But take courage. I have overcome the world. Amen. Isn't that good? We can take any one of those pieces and we can dissect it all by itself, and we can find so much truth and joy in that. And by the way, let me just say this, because God needs me to say it. Peace is not the absence of pain. Peace is what you find when you find Jesus. It's what Jesus does in us. That's why that verse 33 is so important. It's sort of a message inside the message. And it brings us to chapter 17, where the last will and testament of Jesus, these final words, really come to a head. And so Jesus, if you can picture it in your mind's eye, Jesus has his disciples around him. And he's teaching them these important truths leading up to it. And then in chapter 17, Jesus begins to pray. And we hear Jesus' heart for the disciples and for others as he begins to pray. Like I said earlier, we learn so much about someone's heart by the way they pray and by the things they pray for. And so Jesus begins to pray. Here's what I want to do. I want to read all of 17. Now, I've said this, I think, 2 weeks in a row. I don't normally read this much scripture, and here I've done it 2 weeks in a row. Like last time I read Joshua 4, today I need to read John 17. By the way, let me tell you why it's important. In our American culture, we're so used to fast food everything, snippets and pieces. We do it to scripture too. And it's okay to have a daily devotional where you read two or three verses and you get something out of that and glean something out of it. Totally good. Not picking on that. But there are times we need to be patient and read a block of text because the context is so important. And so that's why things like Joshua 4, when we talked about a memorial to remember God's goodness, and that's why chapter 17, which is the entirety of Jesus' prayer, we got to know what he's talking about. So I'm going to read the whole thing to you. You can follow along. I think we'll throw it up on the screen. But follow along in your own Bible and feel free to underline, because you will see some themes, and that's what we miss. We miss the thematic statements where Jesus repeats himself. By the way, do you think Jesus repeats himself because he's forgetful? Anybody? No. He repeats himself because he wants to make sure the people that are listening to this prayer also hear what he's petitioning God for. All right? So let's read it. So chapter 17. Jesus spoke these things, lifting up his eyes to heaven. He said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you. Even as you gave him authority over all flesh, that to all whom you have given him, he may give eternal life. This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you've sent. I glorified you on the earth, having accomplished the work which you have given me to do. Now, Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before the world was. I've manifested your name to the men whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now, they have come to know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words which you gave me, I have given to them. And they received them and truly understood that I came forth from you, and they believed that you sent me. I ask on their behalf. Do not ask on behalf of the world, but of those whom you have given me, for they are yours. And all things that are mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. I am no longer in the world, and yet they themselves are in the world. And I come to you, Holy Father, keep them or protect them in your name, the name which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. While I was with them, I was keeping them in your name, which you have given me, and I guarded them, and not one of them perished, but the son of perdition, so that the scripture would be fulfilled. But now I come to you, and these things I speak in the world, so that they may have my joy made full in themselves. I've given them your word, and the world has hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I don't ask you to take them out of the world, but to keep them from the evil one. They're not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them, set them apart in the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. For their sakes I sanctify myself, that they themselves also may be sanctified in truth. I don't ask on behalf of these alone, but for those also who believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, even as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you sent me. The glory which you have given me, I have given to them, and they may be one, just as we are one. I in them, and you in me, that they may be perfected in unity, so that the world may know that you sent me and love them even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, be with me where I am, so that they may see my glory, which you have given me, for you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, although the world has not known you, yet I have known you, and these have known that you sent me, and I have made your name known to them, and will make it known, so that the love with which you loved me may be in them, and I in them. That's Jesus' prayer. It's his last will and testament. It's the final things that Jesus needs to say, those final words, and he prays, he intercedes in prayer with the Father in these last hours that he has breath in his lungs, life on this earth. In these last few moments, these are the things that he prays. One of the things that we see in that is it's the longest recorded prayer of Jesus in the Bible. Not that he didn't pray longer than 3 minutes or so. He probably did. I would say that we can see places in Scripture where he prayed constantly and all throughout the night and things like that. And of course, if he tells us to pray without ceasing, I would imagine he's in constant contact with the Father. But this is the longest recorded prayer that we have of Jesus in John chapter 17. And he prays in their presence. Again, picture that where the disciples are surrounded and he's sort of giving them this final word of wisdom and letting them know this is what's important. And you're going to have trials in this life, but don't worry. I've overcome this. I've overcome it. So don't be freaked out, you know. And he says all these things. He's giving them these final words. And then in their presence, in their hearing, he begins to pray. And they listen to Jesus' prayer. And he teaches them something about his heart and what is important to him as he prays. This is truly the Lord's Prayer. We see what we all call the Lord's Prayer in Matthew and Luke, you know. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We call that the Lord's Prayer. It is. It's an outline of a prayer. But this, to me, is the Lord's Prayer. This is the Lord's Prayer that he petitions God in the hearing of the disciples so that they'll know what's important and so that God will act. In this prayer in John 17, you have three quick sections, and I just want to outline them for you very fast. The first five verses there, what you see is that Jesus is praying for his glory through the cross. He's praying that God the Father will be glorified, but he's also praying that he will be glorified in the cross. He's finished the work that God set out for him. You see that in verse 4? Of course, everything is fully complete in John chapter 19, where Jesus says, at the cross, it is finished, and he takes his last breath. But Jesus has finished what he came there to do, and now he begins to pray for these disciples as he finishes up this work. And he prays partly that the cross will bring him glory. Why? Is it because Jesus is just hungry for everybody to say, look at how neat Jesus is. We need to, well, he is to a certain degree, but part of what he's doing, it's not a pride issue. It's not saying like me saying to you, I want to glorify myself today if everybody could stand up and sing me a song. You know, that's not what it is. That's not how it works. It's not what Jesus is doing. But he's saying, I want glory here. Why? Because he's going to the cross so that those who are lost can be saved. Do you see that? That's important. And he wants glory given to himself because there's glory in the cross because it's the work that he came set out to do. To die in our place so that we can be set free from our sin. So that we can have life with him. Yes, it's important. And so Jesus is looking forward to the glory that he had with the Father since the beginning of time and before. And will continue and is praying that that glory would continue for the Father and for him. Then verses 6 through 19, we see this second section. And he's praying for the disciples. So again, our mind's eye, we see Jesus teaching. And here he's surrounded by these disciples and he's praying for them and praying very specifically. And what you see as you go through this text is Jesus has a primary concern on his heart that he's lifting up to the Father. And that primary concern is for the relationships of the people that are present. He's praying for the relationship of what's going on there. Like, look at verse 11, for instance. It says this, I'm no longer in the world, and yet they themselves are in the world. And so he says, I come to you, Holy Father, keep them or protect them in your name, the name which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. what's Jesus doing? Well, partly, he's praying for the relationship there, but he's saying, I'm no longer in the world. And so guess what? They're going to be without my presence, my physical, earthly presence, and they're not going to have my protection. And what is he praying for? He's praying to protect them, that God will protect them, even though his physical presence will be absent from them. But he also prays that they will be protected so that they can be one as he and the Father and the Holy Spirit are one. This prayer that Jesus is praying is for their unity together as disciples, that they will have unity, unity like the Trinity has, unity like the Godhead has. This is his primary concern, and he's praying for their protection so that they will do that, so that they will experience something that's amazing that he already experiences with the Father. And so it's important spiritual and theological doctrine that we need to understand. This is the Trinitarian doctrine, which says there's one God, not three. There's one God who has three persons or three components: God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, all one. And it's hard to understand, and this isn't that message on trying to dissect that for you. We've done that some already, and we'll continue to do it. But they are one, always in existence with one another from the very beginning of time and before. The God has always existed in this Trinity, in this three-person way. And they have always had this love for one another. And part of what Jesus is praying for is that they will understand this and that they will love like the Trinity, like the Godhead has existed in complete love and connection. And we see this laid out for us in several places through Scripture where the Trinity is seen expressing this very unique relationship and this kind of relationship toward one another. Like in Genesis chapter 1, you see that they're creating with one another. Or in John chapter 7 and 8, you see that they're united in their motive. The motive, what they're there for, the mission of redeeming sinners and for truth and redemption and holiness. All those things are part of this Godhead, this three-in-one component that makes up who God is. They're affirming one another. We see it in Matthew 3, and loving one another in Mark 9, deferring to one another in John chapter 14, and glorifying one another in John chapter 12. The Father loves the Son through the Spirit, and the Son returns the love to the Father. The Trinity, the Godhead, three-in-one. One God, three persons. And then this complete and absolute connectedness and unity and love that the Godhead has always had, even since the beginning, before there was time. Jesus is praying that the disciples present will have that kind of relationship with one another that Jesus has been a part of since before time began. That's what he's praying. That they will be one as he is one with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Now, let me just ask you on the cuff, does that sound amazing to you that this is Jesus' prayer? That the disciples who follow will have that kind of oneness and unity, the same kind of oneness and unity that the Godhead has with itself? This is Jesus' prayer. So he's praying that these disciples would experience this kind of life-giving relationship with each other. That their hearts would come alive and that they would be able to do this. And by the way, Jesus is not just praying for organizational unity. Organizational unity is nice, which means, okay, everybody, we're all going to stand up at the same time and then sit down at the same time. Let's go. One, two, three, you know, that kind of thing. I know a couple of you have thought, am I supposed to stand up right then? I'm just playing with you. It's all good. But that's organizational unity, like we all are marching the same way. That's important. You know that from in your families. Organizational unity is good. We're all in step with one another, going the same way. In work, it's nice when there's organizational unity. Would you agree with that? Like the captain of the ship says, here's where we're going. And the one underneath that captain goes, okay, I choose to get in alignment with that captain of the ship. And everybody that works for me, get in alignment with me because I'm in alignment with that captain of the ship. And everybody that works for them says, in the morning when I get out of bed, I'm going to align myself with that guy who's aligned with that guy who's aligned with the captain of the ship. And we're all in unity and step with one another with one focus, one goal, one mind. That's nice. Doesn't happen very often when you have a business with more than one person in it, but that's nice. Organizational unity. But guess what? Jesus is talking about more than just organizational unity. Jesus is talking about complete relational unity, interconnectedness. It is interpersonal unity. is what he calls them to do, because he calls the disciples to be together as one, just as Jesus is one with the Father and the Holy Spirit. He calls them to be one. Now, it would be understandable, I think, if we ended the prayer there. And Jesus could have. He could have said, "This is my prayer, God. Glorify me through the cross." Why? Because salvation hangs in the balance for the world. Glorify me through the cross so the people will see that I'm Savior of the world and they'll come to know and believe and be saved. That's important. Jesus could then just say, "God, I'm leaving now. And so I'm praying for your protection over these crazy disciples who are all totally different from one another." And they are very different folks, right? You got some fishermen in there. You got some tax collectors in there. You got a zealot who, you know, is all by himself, on his own marching order typically. You got sword carriers hiding little, you know, conceal and carry weapons, and others that don't, you know, that kind of thing. You've got this ragtag bunch of folks. And Jesus is praying that this ragtag bunch of folks who are from all different walks of life can be one. That's important. One like he's one. But he doesn't end there, and he continues in that prayer. And we see the third part of the prayer is this. Look at verse 20. It says, "I do not ask on behalf of these alone, but for those who also believe in me through their word." You know, what's so amazing about this prayer is that Jesus' dying desire for this life-changing, life-giving relationship, this oneness, this unity, was for all of those who would believe throughout history. That's one of those things we talk about in Acts chapter 2, you know, the early church, they came together, and they fellowshiped with each other, they ate together, they prayed together, and they studied the apostles' doctrine together. Why? So that they would know Jesus, the things that they taught, and the things that they saw, the things that they heard, the prayers that Jesus prayed. And as they come together, Jesus is praying that everyone who hears that message, by the way, are we still hearing that message right now? The answer is yes, we're still hearing it. And Jesus' prayer is that everyone who hears the message through their word, the ones who are sitting there listening to him, will also be one. Jesus is praying for the unity of the church, for oneness, for connectedness. And so Jesus looks ahead through the centuries of time. He looks ahead and prays for all believers who are to come in the future, although a vast majority of them are yet to be born. In that moment when Jesus prays, he's praying, and they were in the heart of the Savior from the very beginning of him. For eternity, he looks ahead. And he knew them all by name, and he knew you by name. He looked and knew your face, and my face, and my name. And he prays that they will be one, like the Trinitarian God, this three-part God, the oneness and the love there, the love, affirmation, encouragement, support, and honor that's there in that Godhead. He prays for oneness like that in us. It's a big prayer. That's a big ask. Would you agree? Sometimes people talk about that's the big ask. It's not fundraising big ask. This is big asking God, this big, huge, enormous thing, and Jesus is praying for those who will believe to be one, as he is one. Now, a couple caveats that are important to make sure we know what oneness means in unity, because I think we get it wrong sometimes. Unity is different than uniformity. Uniformity means we all think exactly the same, we all do the same thing, we all look the same, we all like the same vegetables, we all have the same shoes. That's uniformity. Unity is not uniformity. So that means that I can hate Brussels sprouts, and you can love them, and we can still be brothers and sisters in Christ. That's what it means. That means you could dislike my shoes. Seeing everybody's looking now. You dislike my shoes, you can think those are the stupidest shoes ever, because you're a Nike person, and we still can love each other. Because uniformity is not what we're called to. Unity is what we're called to. To be unified in who God is, that's what unity is. It's not the uniformity view that so many try to proclaim, that you must think exactly the same on every area and especially areas that mean nothing, and that's just not what it means. By the way, there's another one, and that is unity is not hunting for the lowest common theological denominator. Many times, people will search for and try and find the lowest common theological denominator. What that means is you'll have many that will go, hey, can we all just agree that God exists? Yes, great. Then we have unity in that and we're all good. I got to tell you, that is watering down like crazy. We have got to look at what the Bible has to say. We cannot just say, well, we can all agree that, you know, shoes are good, and so therefore we're all good. That's just not the answer. But so many try to do that. It's not what unity means. So how do we find unity? Well, unity is achieved in sticking to what the Bible has to say. Amen. The Bible is our authority. And so when we all stick to what the Bible has to say, guess what? We can find unity. Now, you'll have different interpretations of this and that and whatever, and that will always happen. But I think the Bible was meant for us to know and to read, and the Bible is the best answer for itself. And now we can talk about other things, like in areas that it doesn't say, is there freedom or is there exclusion and all that. And we're not talking about that today. But the reality is the Bible is our authority, and that's where we take our cue for oneness. Our oneness and unity comes out of what God has had to say, and we either accept it as our authority or we don't. But we do. We must, because we're not given any other way. And so we look to that, and we look to other things, like the things that Jesus has taught us, like that self-sacrificing love that we read about, or that new commandment where Jesus says, love one another as I've loved you, that sacrificial love. Those are the kinds of things that bring unity and oneness. To love your neighbor and to love God with all of you and all those things. That's what it means to have this undaunted, goal and mission of Christ and just not be swayed from that. To be focused on what God has called us to. This is why we've done things like laid out those decisions that define us and why we've talked about the things that we do so that we can be unified together in the mission that He's called us to. But always out of the authority of Scripture. But we see places like this that talk about unity. Like, look over at Ephesians. So if you flip over a few books. Acts, Romans, Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. Just listen to the first 6 verses. This is talking about unity. Listen. It says, therefore I, the prisoner of the Lord, that's Paul, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you've been called. With all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love, being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There's one body, that's the church. One Spirit, just as also you were called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. That's what unity looks like. God defines it for us. Is to understand that there is oneness in these things. And Jesus' prayer for God is that we will be one. And that's hard because we love to draw lines and argue about things. That's why denominations exist. They exist because they've said, we're not sure we want this to be our authority. We're going to make up our own line and we're going to draw it and you're different and we're over here. And that's just ridiculousness. What does the Bible say? Let's do our best to understand it and let that be our authority and our guide, because only in that will we find the ability to be one. Only in that can we find the ability to be unified. It's this power of God that does it, that calls us to this unity. And so what? Why is this important? Why do we need to talk about being unified, being one? Why is that so important to us? Well, here it is. This year, we have been called as a church to move. It's been our theme. We've talked about it a lot. And we're drawing the formal component of that to a close here. But we'll talk about it all year because it's what God really has called us as a church to do, is to move. And that's not just move to a new location, but to be in movement, but to be a church in motion. And the reality is He's not calling the church to be in motion and you go your way and you go your way and you go your way and you go your way, because if we all do it our own way, guess what happens? We get scattered in a million different ways. or 400 or 500 different ways, or however many people call Renew home, we all go our own way. But for me, what I see in this move is that part of the move and part of the goal and the desire of God in our move is that we move together. The visual image in my mind all week has been a three-legged race. Everybody knows the three-legged race, right?
No?
Okay, here's how it works. You got two people, and you tie the inside legs together, and then you try and have them run together. And what's necessary for that to happen? You have to have the same goal, the same direction, the same pace, the same move. And that's not uniformity. It's unity. It's oneness and going the right way, the same way, together. And part of what God is calling us to is to move together. But here's the thing. It doesn't just affect the church. Because you know where so much of it begins? Is it begins in your homes. The unity and the oneness surrounded around Scripture in your marriages, with your children, and those that you love. To have unity in what we think and what we do and how we function. To know where we are going as a family. And to say, this is who we are. And I've heard it from Jennifer's mom many times, who said things like this. And I always thought it was interesting, but never made total sense until just this moment. And her name's Darlington. And she'll say, the Darlingtons are an honorable people. I hear her say that all the time to the grandkids, of which there are like 1,400 of, to say the Darlingtons, which includes the Dunlaps and all these other families, are an honorable people. What does that do? It says that this is who we are, this is our identity, this is where we're moving and how we're to function. It gives us a signpost that says this is how we can be unified. And this is what the Bible does for us. It gives us a signpost that says this is where oneness and unity come from, is in the same oneness and unity that God has as the Trinity. And He calls us to do it, to be those people, in our families, with our kids, and in His church, to be one as He is one. Jesus prayed that prayer for Renew Community Church. He did. Do you know that? That as Jesus is praying, that those who will hear the message from the people who were listening to Jesus will be one as He is one. He prayed that prayer for this church. He saw this moment because He's God. He saw this moment. He prays for us to be one. Here's where we go from here, though. Because we have to take a message like this and say, now what? And so what about tomorrow and all that? Well, we see part of this now what in verse 23 of John. So we've got to go back to John chapter 17. Here's 23b. So I'll read all of 23. It says, I in them and you in me, that they may be perfected in unity, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you have loved me. Do you catch what that says there? That Jesus is praying for the unity. But part of the reason behind it is because those who are outside of the faith will see that witness by those who believe and yearn to believe. Francis Schaeffer said this one time. He said, I'll say it twice, but try and catch it. He says, our relationship with each other is the criteria the world uses to judge whether our message is truthful. I'm going to say it one more time. He says, our relationship with each other is the criteria the world uses to judge whether our message is truthful. That means that those who don't know Christ, when they see us, our unity and oneness and love that we have for one another is the criteria that outsiders will use to determine if we're telling the truth. Because if we say that we are the body, and we are the body of Christ as the church, we are together, we are one, and then we backbite and gossip and fight and yell and complain over the colors of the paint or the color of the carpet or how the lights look or any of that stuff, and there's division and people go, forget it, I'm just going to go because you won't do what I want to do and this and that, the outside world sees it and they will go, you are liars. What the world needs to see is unity, not uniformity, but even amidst our differences. And by the way, I just got to say, one reason uniformity would be awesome, like we all wear the exact same thing, we got the same shoes, no one eats Brussels sprouts, you know, that kind of thing. If the reason that would be awesome is it's so much easier to control unity when we're uniform in everything. But we don't do that. That's not what we're called to do. That you can be different than me, but we have unity in love and authority of Scripture and who God is, that same authority and that same love that God has within himself. That's what he calls us to. And so the Christian community is the final apologetic. The apologetics means the defense of the faith. The Christian community is the final apologetic, which means the world will decide whether or not to believe Jesus because of what they see, whether they see love and unity in us. Isn't this one reason so many in the world fight against the church? Because they don't like to see the opposite of what they've been told. Part of it is unity that is the hang-up for so many. And so here's the final piece of the now what, and that is this. That as we begin to transition from this place to the next, and as we have already begun the transition, and we've been talking about it a lot, partly because I don't want you to be surprised, but there will be things that we will disagree on. And the question is, will we still be unified? And will we still be one? We will not like certain things. You will not like some of the colors on the walls. You will not like the floor and what we did with it. You may not even like the wall that where it's placed. And let me tell you, the devil wants to cause division over stupid things like that. Shall I say that again? The devil loves to cause division. He is the liar. He whispers those things in our ears. And I got to tell you, our prayer needs to be Jesus' prayer. Not just in the transition to a new building, but in every time we come together, our prayer needs to be Jesus' prayer that we will be one as he is one. That we will be united together in love and in the authority of Scripture and who he has called us to be. And that's the key, that's the important stuff, that we will be one as he's one. We must pray this prayer. And we must not allow the divider to divide us over the things that don't matter. Who Jesus is important. Who God is important. The authority of Scripture is important. Who he's called us to be is important. Jesus died on the cross for you, that's important. And all the colors and all the chairs and the floor and the building matter not. It's unity that he calls us to. Oneness like he is one. So the question is, what would happen in your marriages if you had that view? If we said we are unified behind Christ, what would happen with your relationship with your kids or in your workplace and in this church? What would happen? I'll tell you that kind of unity and oneness that I'm talking about would be incredibly unique in a church. You know, some of you, that kind of unity doesn't exist in many places. Because it's hard. Because Satan loves to pick, and he loves to cause disunity, and we want our personal preferences, and we will disagree, but we must choose and strive and work and pray and love be in alignment with Christ and be one as he is one. That's our call as we move this year and in the years to come, 2040, if we're still around, it will still be the call of the church to be one as he is one. Will you do that? Can you pray with me that we are one as he is one? That we will be unified that way? So I'm going to pray, but here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to ask you to do something, if you want. I'm going to pray the prayer that Jesus prays. Not the whole thing, don't worry. I'm going to pray that we're one as he's one. And then I'm going to invite you, because I want you to pray that prayer too, I'm going to invite you to communion. Because the main thing that we're unified around is that Christ died for us. His body was broken, his blood was shed so that we can be set free. And I want to invite you to come, go find a station where there's communion. Get a little piece of bread and a cup and go sit back down. And then be patient until we all sit down or we're all together. And then in unity, we share in communion today. It's different than we would normally do that, but it is an act of unity surrounding the cross, because that's where it begins to be unified and to be one. We must be unified around the cross, around what Jesus does. It's where it begins. And so I'm going to ask us to do it. Now, if you don't want to take communion, don't do it. You don't have to. It's not something you should do if you're not ready to do that. But I want to invite you to search your heart and to seek God in that moment and to ask God to make you one with us, that we are one as He is one. And that in that communion, in that moment, that we commune together and that we are a community. Have you ever thought about that word? How you spell it? C-O-M-M-U-N-I-T-Y. The basis of community is unity. And together we'll eat the bread and drink the cup, and I'll lead us through that. So if you would, if you want, I'm going to pray, and John's going to play a little bit, give you time to get up, grab a piece of the little loaf and the juice, and sit back down, and we'll commune together, and then we'll finish up. Let me pray. God, my prayer is that we will be one as you are one. My prayer, Father, is that we collectively will not get hung up on things that don't matter. I pray, God, that you will remove evil influences, that you will remove pride and remove preference on things that don't matter, and instead unify us around the cross. God, we want to be one as you're one, to have that kind of life-giving love and relationship with one another that you have as a part of this Trinity. It's totally unique, Father. I've never seen it in a church before. But I pray that we have it. And I pray that as we have it, that those who need to know who you are will see you in us and desire to follow. Because that was Jesus' prayer. And I pray that that will happen. We will be united in you. That we'll be one in you. So, Father, touch our hearts as we prepare to be unified in this moment of communion. In Jesus' name.
Confident and covered by the power of your
Sins are like scarlet, it makes us white as snow. Jesus says, this is my blood that's shed for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This is the new covenant in my blood. God, let there be something different in this place. We will not allow the stresses of a move or the stresses of a facility or change in this or that or whatever. Let it not create division. Let us be unified in you so that we can be one as you're one. And God, let it not just be about a move, not about a building, but in everything. Let us be united in who you are and united in your love to be one, to be that connected with one another, that we will love one another as you have loved us. Let there be something different here that many of us or most of us have never seen before. Salvation hangs in the balance for thousands around us. Let that be a testimony to your greatness and your goodness. I pray over each one that can hear the sound of my voice this morning that we will be unified and we will desire for that in every moment, every day, and every step, and walk with you. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to finish up with a couple of announcements. We'll take up an offering as we do that. And, you know, part of our unified desire is that we have unity in the things that we do and the heart that God has placed here in this church, and that we will be unified in our desire to feed hungry people and take care of those that are in need, and that there will be unity in our desire to make an impact in our communities and in each other's lives. And part of that does take financial blessings that we can be able to do those things, because when there's a need there, we depend on God to provide the finances for it in our own lives and for us to be a work in this church to be able to do that. And so that's my prayer always, that in offering, just like in communion or in singing or whatever, that it's not a checklist item, that it's something we yearn to do. And that's part of the heart change that I yearn for us, that we will not be afraid to give, that we'll trust God, even with that, and our time, which is so hard. And so that's our prayer, and that God will multiply that gift. So let me pray over the offering, and then a couple last things, and we'll finish up. God, we pray over this offering, that it will be used to bring glory to your name, and that we will always have enough to make the impact in our communities and in each other's lives that we need to. That you will give us an abundance and multiply our gift so that we can fulfill the things you've called us to. And so, Father, we thank you for those that have that heart to give, and give abundantly without fear because of trust for you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Last week, as I alluded to in the message, we talked about Joshua 4. Joshua 4 is that God calls these Israelites as they are moving over into the promised land to take stones and build a memorial so that they would always remember the goodness of God. And they would always remember God's hand at work, and that their children in generations to come would see this group of stones and they would ask, what is this group of stones all about? And that their fathers and their parents would teach them about the goodness of God and the things he'd done. And so the conclusion of that last week was to build our own memorial to remind us of what God has done in this place in this church in a short amount of time. The church is you, not this building. But to remind us of God's hand to start from scratch and to grow to where we are and to see the lives changed that have been changed. And we brought our own stone to place in the memorial, and we have someone that will create something neat out of that that we'll take to the new place. And when your kids grow up and they say, what's that group of stones all about? You have a story to tell them about God's goodness and faithfulness, just like he did with the Israelites. And so if you didn't get a chance to do that last week, when we're all done today, I just want to invite you to take a stone out of the bucket and place it there. That stone group will not stay the same. We're not going to number them and have it exactly the same. We'll create something else out of it. But it will be something that's important for us to remember what God has done and his faithfulness. So when we're done, do that. We need to pray for Laura Robertson's grandma, who apparently had a stroke this morning, so we'll do that here in a moment. Today, we have a tailgate party. And what that means is when we're done, I want to invite you to go down to the other building. And so it's 1.6 miles. You go out here the road, you turn left, and go down to Ritchie Road and turn left, and the building's right there, okay? And we've got guys that came to first service, and they went down to cook hot dogs. And we have other people who brought side dishes and chips and drinks and all that. And we're going to go down, and we're just going to eat and enjoy that time with a little tailgate party. And then after a little while, we'll go inside, and we can walk around. And, you know, we're actually going to play some worship music down there for, you know, three or four songs just to have some fun together, okay? But that signifies one step closer because today is our last day in this place, okay? And so, a little transition. Now, here's what I need from you. If you go inside, there is a working bathroom inside, so that's good news if you need to use the bathroom. There's also a porta potty outside. If you want to brave that, go for it, okay? And but here's the thing I need that's most important. Do not let your children run in there. It is a construction area. There's still nails. There's no railing on the front staircase. And we don't want people to die. That would put just a slight damper on the move to the new building. You know what I'm saying? And so please don't let your children die in the new building. So that's the message. Don't let them go inside and run around. So that means don't let your kids go inside without you. All right? Let me say it one more time. Do not let your children go inside and die. Okay, please. Or if you have, you know, someone around that's 25, 35, 40 years old, and they can't be trusted on a stairwell with no rail, don't go inside. That's just how it goes, okay? And so please be very careful of that. But we're going to go down. Even if you didn't bring any food, no problem. Come down, hang out. There will be plenty. If there's not, we'll order pizza. That's how we roll, okay? And so it wouldn't be a Renew party if we didn't have pizza. That's just how it goes. So we're going to go down there, and you can go right now. We can go down. We'll eat some food and just hang out. And then when things start to slow down, looks like you're done eating hot dogs or whatever. If you don't like hot dogs, guess what? There's other food there. Come eat like 14 pounds of beans and then just, you know, whatever. It's all good. So come on down anyway. And then when things start to slow down, we're going to have the praise team go in, and we'll play some music. And that'll be our first time to do that. It's dusty in there, okay? If you have asthma problems or something, you don't want to deal with the dust, talk to me. I'll get you a mask, okay? And so that's how we're going to do that. So we're going to leave here and go straight down there. Again, now next week, let me tell you what next week's going to look like. You know how over the time, the year and a half or so we've been together, I've said on a few occasions, wouldn't it be cool if, I've said that a lot, I know, but wouldn't it be cool if we had church where we had to bring like lawn chairs and stuff? That's next Sunday. Okay? So bring lawn chairs, maybe a jacket, and we're going to have worship outside next Sunday. It'll be one service at 10:30. No 9 o'clock service next week. The good news is we could fit everybody in one service outside, right? And so 10:30, it'll be a one-hour service. There won't be any kids' classes because there's just no way to pull it off, okay? And so, but it'll be a one-hour thing. Don't miss it. It's going to be our first moment to be there. If the weather's bad, don't camp out at home. Come anyway because we'll go inside if the weather's really bad. We'll do that informally. You know what I'm saying? And so we'll go inside and we'll make it work. But next Sunday, 10:30, one service. Make sure you're keeping track on Facebook and all that good stuff and at the new facility. And then that next week, hopefully, will be all fully functional and all good. Now, to do that, though, we need your help. Starting Tuesday, we need help painting. Now, let me say this. I love the children of this church. We have like 14 gazillion of them. But the children are not invited to this painting project. We will have other painting projects. But here's why. And that is, some of our floors need to be kept halfway decent because we're going to do some different things with them. And in the past, as much fun as it was, we've painted in this facility before, and there was more paint on the floor and each other than there was on the walls. And so we're going to just say, if you want to paint, help out. Starting Tuesday, we're going to be ready to roll with that. If you want to paint during the day, you got time, just send me a note or just come down. We'll probably have things set up. But in the evenings, hopefully we'll have people there that are really serious, and we can, because we've got to prime basically the whole thing first. And then we'll figure it out from there, okay? So we need lots of help to get that done. Aren't you glad I remembered to turn my mic off for a cough? Anyway, so this week we need lots of help to get that done. Next week, again, lawn chairs, one service, 10:30. And then tomorrow night we have our third service. It will still be here. I don't know if that Monday night will be our last one. Come back. I think the topic for tomorrow night at 7 o'clock is going to be, what does turn the other cheek mean? So we're going to deal with that hard topic. And so if you want to come back and deal with what does turn the other cheek mean, you should be here tomorrow night for our well service. Do a little unplugged music, and then we'll tackle that topic and other questions if we have time, if you want to ask about science or the Bible or whatever, and we'll do that. So tomorrow night at 7. As you head out the door, make sure you get a round out questions. Those are questions that help keep the message from today in the front of your mind. And I'd love for you to keep on track with that, okay? Last thing. This prayer for unity, again, is something that we need to pray all the time. It's not just about moving to another place. It's something that is the DNA that we want God to continue to create here, as we are one, as He is one. And so, I'm going to pray, and I'm going to actually pray over lunch now. That way we don't have to try and wrangle everybody together and figure that out. Okay, so, I'm going to pray over that. Last thing I got to say is this. I love you. I'm thankful for you. I'm excited about where God's taking us and what He's about to do. Remember, it's not about a building. We should be excited about a building, but what we're excited about is what God is doing in us. And we want to glorify His name in everything, just like Jesus' prayer, just to bring glory and all that. And so I'm going to pray over all that, and then my encouragement would be, find a kid that's probably yours and head down that way. Okay? All right, let's pray. God, we praise Your holy name. You are great and glorious and awesome in every way. And so, Father, I pray, because You are great and glorious and awesome, we come to You to talk to You, and we're so thankful that You want us to. And so, God, first and foremost, I pray that glory is given to Your name in everything. As we glorify Jesus and the cross, as we share in communion, as we come and we look at Your word, and as we pray, let glory be brought to You, because You are good and awesome and the only one deserving of our ultimate praise. And so, Father, I pray with all earnestness and sincerity that You will knit us together as one, that we will be a body like no other, a church like no other, that we will be one as You are one, and that people that continue to come and to come and be a part of this body will be one with us, and that we will be one, no matter from where they come from, no matter what background or where they've been or what they've done or whatever it is, make us one. No matter how different we may be, make us one as You're one. Let us experience that life-giving love and relationship that You, Father, have with the Son and the Holy Spirit. Let us be one. Let that be the order of the day. Cast away any division, any frustrations, any anger that we might have with one another. Remove it. Remove a spirit of division that would ever be present today or any day. And instead, give us a spirit of unity and love and oneness as You are one. Father, I thank You for the food that we're about to share. Let that sharing of table fellowship grow us closer together. And Father, continue to show us ways to feed hungry people in our community. I pray for those that are sick, Laura's grandma, those that are hurting, and those that are broken, that You will give them comfort and peace as we all need. Let us be givers of Your peace as well as we go from this place. And let our unity show the world what You look like. We praise You for all of it, what You've done, what You're doing, what You will do. In Jesus' name, amen. See you at the other place. Oh, it's Jamie. That's how it was. Oh, it's Jamie. He's a kid.
Thank you. Jesus.